to talk about how you organize your data files as a practical matter. You need to consider where your data are going to live and who they are going to hang out with. We are going to dive deeper into organizing your SPSS workflow. If you are going to use SPSS, then we need to talk about best practices for organizing your data. You don't want to have sloppy data and multiple confusing data sets scattered all around. Here's my advice for how to structure your files so that you will have everything that you need and you can find what you're looking for. This is a folder that shows you how I typically organize an analysis. If I consulted with you on a project and you brought me your data in Excel, this is what I would give you after we completed the analysis. Let me break this apart and show you everything inside. The very first thing that you need is a folder to organize your data. Because I work with multiple researchers, I always name the folder using the researcher's name and one or two words that describe their research. This is some research that I did with a marketing class about a product developed here in Springfield, Missouri called Replay. It's a product that increases hydration. You add it to a glass of water and it will help move water into your cells and hydrate them. It has electrolytes, but unlike something like Gatorade, this product does not contain sugar. The developers say that one benefit of Replay is that it does not increase urine output. So you drink a glass of water with Replay and the water goes into your cells rather than immediately making you pee. This is one of the claims that we set out to test with our marketing class. Disclaimer, this is not a paid endorsement. These guys are friends of mine, and I did this video for free to thank them for letting us use their product for testing in a research classroom. I will pretend that the lead researcher in the class is a student named David. I would label the folder with David's first and last name, and then something specific about his research. And rather than saying that David was interested in urine output, I'll just call this hydration. We actually divided the class into three groups, and they each provided their data on their own Excel spreadsheet. Now, whenever you have multiple people providing data on multiple worksheets, it is absolutely imperative that you create the Excel spreadsheet with all of the variables first. Then you distribute exact copies of that Excel workbook to each group. Once they have their copy, it's imperative that everyone enter their data exactly the same way. So we actually did a class session on how to record the data properly so that everyone was recording it in exactly the same way. Now, you may not be collecting raw data from multiple sources, but I do make this a point. If you have raw data, you should always keep a copy. In this case, I made a second folder called Raw, in which I keep all of the raw data. And of course, this folder is optional if you need it. So David combined all of the class data from all of his classmates into a single Excel spreadsheet. This is the data that will go into SPSS. Now, I have three sheets in this Excel dataset. The first sheet is the actual data that will go into SPSS. The second sheet is the full dataset, including all of the qualitative data that I do not need for this analysis. And the third sheet is a codebook. The codebook tells us what every variable is, its label, and the levels of measurement as appropriate. Next, I bring the Excel data into SPSS. I open SPSS, And then I use the commands File, Import Data, Excel. I navigate to my Documents folder, where I have my special Introduction to Stats Class folder. I find this particular hydration project and the Excel workbook. Because I have already prepared the data in Excel, the default import settings in SPSS will work fine. I will save this data as an SPSS file with the name Replay Data Clean. Now at this point, I would do data cleaning and create the new variables that I will need. And that fully cleaned data set is what you see here. So now it is time for an analysis. I want a one-way ANOVA comparing the average urine output by type of drink. I will get a plot of the means. I will run a post hoc using Tukey's Honestly Significant Difference test. And under Options, I will get Descriptive Statistics, Effect Size, and Homogeneity Tests. But instead of clicking OK to run the analysis, I will use the Paste button to paste the syntax to a syntax window. Because my dataset is in the same folder where all of the other files reside, I can now use syntax to open the SPSS dataset anytime. Copy the syntax. I paste the file opening syntax at the head of this syntax file. I save my syntax file to the desktop, just for now. And I quit SPSS. We will pretend that it has been several days or even weeks since we have looked at this data. At some time in the future, I double-click on my syntax file to open SPSS. The syntax file itself also opens. I select all and press the green triangle for run. SPSS finds and opens my dataset, because I always keep it in the same folder location. It then runs my ANOVA, and it shows me the results in a new output window. I save the new output file to the desktop. And then I use the export command to export this same output to Microsoft Word. Now, anytime that I want, I can open this RTF document in Microsoft Word, even if I do not have SPSS on my computer. I may do some basic cleaning. I might remove the notes table. Or I might change the font size or the spacing. I prefer to save my RTF as a native Word document. I can then discard the original RTF file. I then keep all of these documents in my project folder so I can always find them later. I mentioned that I export to Microsoft Word so that I, or anyone else, can open the output even if we do not have SPSS installed. But if you have the free SPSS Smart Reader, you can also open and edit SPSS output without having the full SPSS statistics program installed. The SPSS Smart Reader lives in the same IBM folder as SPSS statistics. But unlike Microsoft Word, the SPSS Smart Reader allows you to actually edit the output. For example, I can clean up this chart. Double-click to open the chart editor. Remove the fill and border. Click Apply. I used this example to teach you about organizing your data sets and your output files. But let's check in and see what we've learned about this product. We see that the average urine output was in fact lower for replay than for a competitor's product or for regular water. The overall ANOVA was statistically significant. Post hoc testing showed us that the difference for the competitor that uses high fructose corn syrup was statistically significant, but the difference between replay and water was not. Now, these results were for a relatively small sample, and we relied on self-measurements, so we want to be cautious in our interpretations. But we can say that the change was in the expected direction, and that these results support the claim that hydration with replay is achieved with less urine output than other options. These results might be used to justify a larger, better-controlled study. And in case you are interested, here is how I would write up these results in APA style. Now you have everything that you need all in one place. You have your original raw data, the organized data and codebook in Excel, the SPSS dataset, the syntax used to run the analysis, the output of the analysis, and a copy of that output that can be read in Microsoft Word. If you are running multiple analyses, or if you are working on a thesis or a dissertation, you may create subfolders for each analysis. Regardless, I recommend keeping your main analysis dataset front and center in your research folder. And that is how you can organize your SPSS analysis in a single folder.